Morning, everybody. Thank you again for joining us. I am Jamie Crossman-Smith. I'm Head of Data Assurance Services here at Grant Thornton for the Financial Services Group. Please note that this virtual event is being recorded and will be distributed to those registered after the event. If there's any questions you'd like to ask, please could you submit them via the chat function, and we will try our best to address these at the end of the session. And finally, do apologise in advance for any unexpected interruptions. We are recording this from my home in the sunny Yorkshire Dales today. There may be certain disruptions out of our control, postmen, children, whatever. We do hope that we will be able to make it through the call without any, though. And thank you in advance for your understanding. And can I ask once again, can I make sure that everybody who's joined is on mute and your cameras are off? There's a lot to get through, and I'm hoping we've got enough time. Focus will be on machine learning today, including a live demo to show you how simple the process can be. If we've got time, we'll get to blockchain, RPA, and questions. But if you've got any burning questions afterwards, or if you want some further understanding of what we've shown you today, please do feel free to drop me a line. Well, today I'm joined by two members of our team, Chitvan Jindal and Carolis Slavicius, and I will let them introduce themselves.
Thanks, Jamie. Hi, everybody. So I'm Chitvan. I joined Jamie's team just over a year ago now, moved over from New Zealand, where I looked after a large FinCrime analytics project, implementing FinCrime capabilities across one of New Zealand's largest banks. And for the last year, I've been helping Jamie kind of uplift audit analytics at Grant Thornton. And now I'm helping focus our clients on uplifting analytics and their audit function across the board as well. Carolis?
Hello, everyone. I'm Carolis. I'm in the team with Jamie and the data assurance team in FSBRS in Grant Thornton. I'm an assistant manager in the team, and that's what I do. I'm specialized in SQL, R, Python coding, and assist the team with developing automation tools and any analytics features for the clients and internal company needs.
Great. Thanks, Chitvan, and thanks, Carolis. So without any further ado, let's crack on. Artificial intelligence is a huge topic today and is getting bigger all the time. Thanks to the success of many well-known technologies, talking to your computer or smartphone is both fun and helpful to discover whatever you want to find out. As you talk to your phone, it learns more about the way you talk and makes fewer mistakes in understanding the requests. Well, it's meant to anyway. I think everybody's had the same issues with Alexa that I have. The capability of your smartphone to learn and interpret your particular way of speaking is an example of artificial intelligence, and part of the tech used to make it happen is called machine learning. You likely make limited use of machine learning and AI all over the place today without really knowing about it. For example, the capability to speak to devices and have them actually do what you intend is an example of machine learning. Likewise, recommender systems such as those found on Amazon or eBay help you make purchases based on criteria such as previous product purchases or products that complement your previous choices. The use of both AI and machine learning is only going to increase with time. You find machine learning used in a great many applications today. The only problem is that the technology works so well that in many cases, you don't know that it even exists. In fact, you might be surprised to find that many devices in your home already may use machine learning. Unless you drive an old banger like my car, machine learning appears probably in your car and it appears a lot in the workplace. In fact, the uses for both AI and machine learning number in the millions, all safely out of sight, even when they're quite dramatic in nature. So here's some more uses. Fraud detection. Say you get a call from your credit card company asking whether you made a particular purchase. The credit card company isn't being nosy. It's simply alerting you to the fact that someone else could be making a purchase using your card. As the AI embedded within the credit card companies detected unfamiliar spending patterns and alerted someone in the bank to it. Complex analysis. Humans often need help with complex analysis because there are literally too many factors to consider. For example, the same set of symptoms could indicate more than one problem a doctor or the expert may need help in making a diagnosis in a timely manner to save a patient life. Automation. Ultimately, any form of automation can benefit from the addition of AI to handle unexpected changes or events. The problem with some types of automation today is that an unexpected event, which is an object, for example, in the wrong place, can actually cause the automation to stop. Adding AI to the automation can allow the automation to handle unexpected events and continue as if nothing happened. We'll discuss that more when we talk about robotic process automation later. Customer service. The customer service you call today might not even have a human behind it. The automation is good enough to follow scripts and use various resources to handle the majority of the questions. And even with good voice inflection, you might not even be able to tell you're talking to a computer. And finally, predicting wait times. Most people don't like waiting when they have no idea of how long the wait will be. Machine learning allows an application to determine waitings based on staffing level, availability of resources, and so on. As any technology becomes more prevalent, so does the hype, and AI certainly has a lot of hype surrounding it. For one thing, some people have decided to engage in fear-mongering rather than science. Killer robots or cute robots, such as Johnny Five or Wall-E, really aren't going to be the next big thing. Your first real experience with an android is more likely to be in the form of a healthcare assistant. Think Baymax in Disney's Big Hero 6, or possibly a really dull co-worker. No comment. The reality is that you interact with machine learning in far more mundane ways already. You may have also heard the terms machine learning and AI used interchangeably. AI includes machine learning, but machine learning doesn't fully define AI. The simple answer is, for AI, think about that fully human-like android and all the things that they can do. And for machine learning, think about a computer algorithm. The more dull definition is machine learning and AI both have strong engineering components. That is, you can quantify both technologies precisely based on theory rather than simple hypothesis. In addition, both have strong science components through which people test concepts and create new ideas. But finally, machine learning also has an artistic component, and this is where talented scientists can excel. AI and machine learning both seemingly defy logic, and only a true artist can make them work as inspected for what you want them to. Now, we all think that this stuff is the domain of clever PhDs. However, the tools and technologies are now available to everyone on the desktop. It is true, having a PhD or a quant degree does help you understand how your AI and machine learning technology works. However, you don't need one to be able to use it. Many experts think of it rather like driving a car. To drive a car, you don't need to be a mechanic. However, we all know it helps if you break down or if you have another problem with your car. People who use machine learning today don't always need a detailed understanding of the math. They just need to make sure it gets to the right result. We will help you understand this concept later when we do a demonstration of machine learning live today. AI, as we know it today, began with a publication entitled Computing Machinery Intelligence in 1950. In this paper, Alan Turing explored the idea of how to determine whether machines can think. This led to the imitation game involving three players, two humans and one computer. Players one and two, being one computer and one human, must convince the remaining human that they are the other human and not the machine. Sounds like a long time ago. Well, then you may be surprised to know that the first self-driving car was actually created in 1984. This stuff has actually been around a long time, and therefore, if you think about the computer capability of the time, you know, the ZX Spectrum, the Commodore, etc., then much of this can't actually be that complex. The optimism of the 1950s and 1960s led scientists to believe that the world would produce intelligent machines in as little as 20 years. We all know that wasn't quite true. After all, machines were doing all sorts of amazing things, such as playing complex games. Machine learning also has very many fad uses today. For example, some people are using machine learning to create Picasso-like art from photos. Of course, the problems with such use, for one thing, it's doubtful that anyone would really want an AI-created Picasso except as a novelty. The point of art isn't in creating an interesting interpretation of a particular real-world representation, but rather in seeing how the artist interpreted it, for which machine learning, no one actually cares. However, machine learning cannot provide the sort of AI that the movies present. Even the best algorithms can't think, feel, or present any form of human awareness. What machine learning can do is perform predictive analytics far faster than any human can. Humans still need to consider the implications of that analysis, making the required moral and ethical decisions. We will consider this later in this presentation. But put in simple terms, forgetting the maths, what is machine learning? Say, for example, I create a very simple program that can add two data inputs together, say 10 plus 10, which is equal to the result 20. Machine learning turns this process around. Imagine in this case that you know you have inputs such as 10 and 10, and you know that the result is 20. However, say that you don't know that the function that was applied to create the result, which is an addition. In building a machine learning model, you can supply an algorithm with all sorts of examples of the desired inputs and results expected from those inputs. 2 and 2 and 4, 100, 130, 2, 230, and so on. The algorithm then figures out what the function is. It learns the answer in this case from a simple addition. It figures out 10 plus 10 is equal to 20. 2 plus 2 is equal to 4. 100 plus 130 is equal to 230. A single learner algorithm can learn many different things, but not every algorithm is suited for certain tasks. Some algorithms are general enough that they can play chess, recognize faces on Facebook, and diagnose cancer in patients. A machine learning algorithm takes the inputs in each of these cases and identifies the underlying function in every case. But the function is specific to the kind of task that you want the algorithm to perform. The secret to machine learning is generalization. The goal is to generalize the output so that it works on data beyond the data that you set up and train the model with. For example, consider a spam filter on a PC. Your dictionary contains 100,000 words, and that's probably a small dictionary. A limited training data set of 4,000 or 5,000 word combinations must create a generalized function that can then find spam in, say, 2 to the power 100,000 combinations that the function may see when working with the actual data. Moving on to slide 2. Learning comes in many flavors dependent on the algorithm and its objectives. You can divide machine learning algorithms into 3 main groups based on their purpose. Today, we will consider 2 of these, supervised learning and unsupervised learning, and we will consider 2 of the general ways algorithms solve problems. Supervised learning occurs when an algorithm learns from inputs and actual outputs. The previous example of the addition function is an example of supervised learning. The supervised approach is indeed similar to human learning. Imagine under the supervision of a teacher, the teacher provides good examples for the student to memorize, and then the student works out general rules from these specific examples. Unsupervised learning occurs when an algorithm learns from plain examples without any associated response, leaving the algorithm to determine data patterns on its own. This type of algorithm is generally more complex to consider, as the algorithm tends to restructure the data into something else, such as new features it can work with to figure possible answers out. Unsupervised algorithms are quite useful in providing humans with insights into the meaning of data and provide useful inputs to supervised machine learning algorithms. For example, a child may learn with the shape sorter that a square shape will go into a square hole. The child may then try to put different objects from around the house through the square hole, understanding that the common characteristic is a square, but not really understanding what the object or what it's used for. Another example is recommendation systems that you find on the web in the form of marketing automation are based on this type of learning. The marketing automation algorithm derives its suggestions from what you've bought in the past. The recommendations are based on an estimation of what group customers you resemble the most, and they're inferring your likely preferences based on the group. Data scientists will also talk about different types of problems that need to be solved using algorithms. 2 of the ways algorithms solve problems, whether these are regression problems or classification problems. Both of these require different algorithms. A regression algorithm, for example, may determine the average price of houses in the London area. Remember the term line of best fit from school? Well, that's all this is. A classification algorithm may distinguish between the different type of flowers, say, based on some of their characteristics. An example of a classification algorithm is a decision tree model, which we will demo later. So I hope you can see machine learning algorithms aren't what you probably thought they were, and the basic concepts are actually quite simple. Whatever problem you give it, all the machine learning algorithm will do is find the most likely or the optimal solution dependent on the algorithm you choose. Even though supervised learning is the most popular, all machine learning algorithms respond to the same logic. The central idea is that you can represent reality using a mathematical function that the algorithm doesn't know in advance, but can guess after having seen some example data. You can express reality and all this challenging complexity in terms of unknown mathematical functions that machine learnings find and make advantageous. This concept is the core idea for all machine learning algorithms. So just to play that back, the basics of machine learning are the fact that whatever algorithm you give, you use to train your data on, it will figure out what the most optimal solution is. So imagine a machine learning algorithm is a black box. You select the machine learning algorithm you wish to use for your problem, and then you train it with some data. Training a machine learning algorithm means that, like that 20 plus 10 plus 10 equals 20 example before, you give it some input data and the expected result, and you get it to work out the mathematical formula required, which in that case is a plus, i.e. 10 plus 10 is equal to 20. To give you an idea of what happens in the training process, imagine a child learning to distinguish trees from other objects. Before the child can do so independently, a teacher presents the child with a certain number of tree images, complete with all the facts that make a tree distinguishable from other objects in the world. Such facts could be features such as wood, bark, branches, leaves and needles, roots, and the fact that a tree is planted into the soil. A child produces an idea of what a tree looks like by contrasting the display of tree features with the images of the other different objects, such as pieces of furniture that are made of wood, but of course do not share the same characteristics with the tree. A machine learning classifier algorithm works the same way. It builds cognitive capabilities by creating a mathematical formulation that includes all the given features in a way that creates a function that can distinguish one class of objects from the other. The process that goes on inside the black box, which maps input characteristics to outputs or results, is known as mapping. The algorithm then searches amongst all the possible variants of its parameter combinations in order to find the best one that allows the correct mapping between the features in classes during training, the optimal solution. For example, understanding that something has leaves, branches, bark, roots may well be a tree. We said before that machine learning algorithms are just optimization algorithms, and this clearly demonstrates this. The machine learning algorithm, after having worked out all the various different combinations of what may constitute a tree, will then work out what is the most optimal, i.e. quickest or most efficient way of identifying what a tree is. Now imagine a child learning what it really is in an effort to figure out their own idea of a tree. The child will experiment with many different creative ideas by assembling their own knowledge and experience. Naturally, the parents are involved in this phase, and they provide relevant environmental inputs, and this is partly why kids, as we all know, ask so many infuriating questions. Likewise, in machine learning, someone has to provide the right learning algorithms and supply some non-learnable parameters, and we call them hyperparameters. Choose a set of examples to use from the training set and select the features that accompany the examples. Just as a child can't always learn to distinguish between right and wrong if left alone in the world, so machine learning algorithms need human beings to learn successfully. And just as a child makes some mistakes, so will a machine learning algorithm. As we said before, machine learning algorithm strength is that they can find generalized solutions to problems. As we will see in the following demonstration, that doesn't mean they will get it right every time, but does or should mean that they get it right most of the time. And if they haven't got it right, you're probably using the wrong machine learning algorithm, if you should be using a machine learning algorithm at all. So as we said before, machine learning algorithms learn off samples of data. You can't give an algorithm a picture of every tree in the world. So think about the controversial example of children watching violent films. Some specialists and parents stick rigidly to the age classification of films because they don't want their children learning about violence and associating that violence with particular scenarios. You could say that if a child was pushed in front of the television and watching a lot of violent videos, then their behavior may end up being biased towards what they've learned through those videos. Another reason, if I needed more for this lockdown, it'll be over soon. Another example is a photo classification algorithm. The algorithm may be trained on photos of cats and dogs, but imagine if you weren't so careful with selection of that training set. Maybe all the cats had collars on. And if this were the case, the machine learning algorithm may associate having a collar with being a cat. Of course, we all know this is incorrect, as dogs can also have collars. What happens if you were to only train the algorithm on pictures of dogs and cats and then expect it to classify a picture of a rabbit? As we said previously, one of the strengths of machine learning is being able to generalize answers. Overgeneralization, or even worse, bias, can cause significant problems. Imagine in the real world a credit model in a bank which has access to customers' ethnicity, and the machine learning algorithm learns that if you're black, you're more likely to default on credit. And then when that model is put in production, it rejects black people who apply for loans because of the color of the skin. Everybody knows that isn't acceptable and isn't the right answer. That's why selecting the right training set to train your model is absolutely critical. Data scientists, when they pick a sample, often split the sample into two parts. They will use 70 to 80% of the data to train the model and the remaining 20 or 30% to validate the model. Data scientists will then use various scoring metrics for assessing and evaluating model quality. In particular, they're very attuned to checking in models' predictive ability or propensity to error. These evaluation techniques include confusion matrices and learning curves. We will see how this is achieved in the demonstration shortly. And in identifying whether a machine learning solution is good enough to create good solutions, machine learning models trade off simplicity and complexity. If you intend to achieve the best predictive performance, you need to find a solution using trial and error on your data. Data scientists often find that the most simple solution is the best one. Whereas many diverse machine learning algorithms may exist, the simplest is often the best. For those of you familiar with the work of the theologian William of Ockham, this is a prime example of Ockham's razor in practice. So moving on to slide 3. Before we jump into the live demo, there are many available tools to be able to perform machine learning. These include tools such as Python and R, which allow the user to code machine learning solutions. In reality, one is just as good as another, and users tend to stick with what they know. If you were born speaking English in England and then you move to France, it will take you a long time to pick up the French language to a conversational level. And this is true for Python and R. In general, mathematicians and scientists are more familiar with R, and developers are more familiar with Python. And whilst there are a vast array of solutions you can build using these scripting tools, it requires in-depth knowledge of the technology in scripting. However, there are drag and drop tools such as Alteryx 9, which allow you to perform machine learning without requiring code to be scripted. Alteryx and Naim are very similar in operation. Although Alteryx requires a license fee to be paid, Naim is open source. Like Python and R, this means Naim has lots of extra features that power users have created. Here in my team at Grant Thornton, we use Naim. I said earlier I would show you a demonstration of machine learning, so here's one I prepared earlier. So I hope everybody can see my screen. So here is a real-life demo of a machine learning algorithm, a simple decision tree classifier. And this workflow demonstrates how a simple classifier is built and applied to new data. And the task that it's going to do here is to predict the income group from demographic attributes from census data in a file called adult CSV. So this is an example of a real model that we could build here at Grant Thornton, where it takes census data and it tries to work out from the census data and the demographic attributes within whether you are likely to earn more than 50,000 or less than 50,000. So here's how it works in practice. This first box here, the file reader, is where we would read in the data file containing the adult CSV. If I wanted to load any CSV or any Excel file, I would just drag the same box down from the top and drag it into the workflow. Now let's open it up. So you can see the data file here and here, see where it's being configured. So I'm going to read in certain, I'm going to read in the column headers, I'm going to ignore spaces and tabs, and you can see the array of data that's in here. So I'm happy with that. That's the data set I want to analyze, and I'm going to run it. I'm going to load it. So I left click and I execute. And it goes green. So now my model has the data file loaded. So in data science, now that I've got a data file, I might want to understand some statistics about it to make sure that it's a fair sample. So quite simple, I'm going to execute some basic statistics here. And if I open this up, I can see all sorts of different statistics, the min, max, the mean, the median, the standard deviation, and so forth. And in data science, I might want to have a look through that and check that actually, you know what, I've picked the right sample to train my model from. But then, of course, a picture paints 1,000 words. So when I'm doing my comparison, I might want to check that I might want to color code what's in that data file. So red for income of less than £50,000 and blue for income of more than £50,000. Let's go. Let's execute that. Gone green. Let's open it. And as you can see here, it's taken the data set that I had before. And for those less than 50,000, it's colored them red. And for those more than 50,000, it's colored them blue. So that makes it easier for the user to be able to see. Now, as I said originally, when we're creating a data science model, I'm going to want to train my model, and then I'm going to want to validate my model. And I split the data set that I've got into two. And it's roughly 80-20 or 70-30 that I might choose to use. So I'm going to split my data set into two to train my model and to validate my model. There you go, it's gone green. So the next step is actually to train the model. Now here, I'm going to use a decision tree learner. And a decision tree learner is a simple example of a classification model. It's going to take that file, adult CSV, and if each iteration, each record in there, it's going to work out what the propensity and the relative probabilities of somebody being on more than 50,000 or less than 50,000, depending on the data that's in there, whether that be your ethnicity, your job, whatever else. So let's run it. And you see, it doesn't take very long at all. Now that I've built that model, what I would do in practice if I was to put that model into production, I would create a PMML file, which is basically, now that it's learned what it needs to learn, it's all the additional parameters and the bits inside that make it learn what it's learned. I can take that and put that in production using that PML file. But now I've done it, let's validate it using 20% of data. This takes a little bit longer. Let's see how it's good. When it's complete, we'll see how good it is at predicting whether somebody's on more or less than 50,000. Okay, so I can see my basic spreadsheet again. I can see what it's done. If I scroll back up to the top, I can see, for example, on this one, the income was 50,000 and my prediction was right. The next one, it didn't do so well on. The next one, it got right. The income was less than or equal to 50,000. And my prediction is it was less than or equal to 50,000. And remember that from a sample, a machine learning is never going to get everything exactly right. And you don't want it to get everything exactly right, because you want it to be able to generalize. So how well did it do? Let's run the scorer. In this case, a confusion matrix, which shows us how well that predictor has done. Gone green. Let's open it. Okay. So here's my confusion matrix. Here's how I score how well my machine learning algorithm has done. Here I can see, for example, that it's correctly identified 4,551 records from the sample who were on less than 50,000. And it's done the same, and it's done it incorrectly for 386 above 50,000, and vice versa here, where it's decided that 673 are above or below 50,000 when they should be above, and 903 are above when they should be above. So this tells me that the error rate in this model is 16.26%, which I may or may not be able to live with, but I can see quite clearly here that it does very well in predicting incomes less than 50,000. Now, as a data scientist, I might think that's good enough. I might think that's bad enough. It depends whether that 15% of error is acceptable to your business or not. What I might want to do as a data scientist is I might say, right, I know it's good at predicting people on incomes less than 50,000. I need another model to sit alongside this to refine and tune the people above 50,000. When I use more than one model in a chain, that it becomes an ensemble model. But let's see maybe why it is decided to not be very good at picking up incomes over 50,000. Let's run this pie chart. There we go. So if I open up this pie chart, I can see quite clearly here that my sample was dominated 75% with incomes below 50,000. So it didn't have a lot to learn off for incomes above 50,000. So actually, maybe I could go back and say, did I pick the right sample? So I hope that's been a useful exercise for everybody to see how simple you can do machine learning in practice and how the tools and techniques are available to users on their desktop. And if you want to be able to use it in your everyday job, you don't need to have a degree in coding. It helps to understand maths, but to do the basic stuff, you can do it on your desktop. Let's go back to the slides. So the slides here on slides 4 to 6 speak for themselves. And there is one prevalent theme if you look across all of this. No one really understands how some of these models work. Whereas in the simple decision tree model shown previously, you can see a representation in some of the inner workings of the tree. Some of the more complex algorithms, such as deep learning, no one knows how they work, even the developer. What goes on inside that black box is just far too complicated. And if this results in detriment to the customer, well, what happens then? And if it does, who is liable? Is it the bank? Or is the AI itself culpable? Sounds crazy? Well, this is exactly what is being worked through right now. And then finally on this slide is GDPR. Think Cambridge Analytica and just think about some of the data the companies hold on you or can get from you. Your mobile phone, for example. Do they know where you are? Do they know what you've been looking at on the internet? Can they read your messages and what you post on social media? Because you do all that from your phone. What about the pictures on your device? Think about this new NHS contact tracing app. They even know who's been near you and possibly for how long. Scary. What is legal here, I would probably argue, isn't the real problem. It's what's ethical. I know that you as my customer, say between 25 and 30, have half filled in a mortgage application, have been visiting furniture shops and saving money, and have currently spent money in different coffee shops in different areas of the city you live in every Saturday. I can tell all that as a bank from the information I hold on you and your transactions. You're looking at houses, maybe. Do I send you a text with an awesome mortgage offer on it just when you are actually in a house for sale? Maybe this is your second visit to that house, and if your privacy settings aren't set correctly on your app, I can work that out from where you are. Maybe I know more than I should because you have weak privacy controls on Facebook and Twitter, and I can read what you've been writing. I can send you a message with that offer on. Do I do that? Am I legally allowed to do that? Even if I am, is it moral? There's lots of risks on the next few slides, but there's a few that stand out for me. Like the currency flash crashes caused last year, caused by two algorithms at different banks trading against each other. Cyber, get hacked, break your AI, then you've got a problem. Then probably the most important one, the future of work. How will we make money when AI and robots are doing our jobs? People may need to be made redundant, and trust me, planning and executing that sort of job totally sucks. You have lots of HR hoops and that, but actually when it comes down to it, just comes down to one thing. I'm going to have to tell people I've worked with and I respect that we don't want them anymore. What does that do to the individual, to who we have a duty of care, and of course to your organisation when the press finds out you're laying off staff because you replaced them with tech? It doesn't look good. And when that happens on scale across the economy, what happens then? So, Chipman, could you tell us a little bit more about the use of machine learning in internal audit?
Interesting segue going from those conversations about shifting resources to use of machine learning in audit. I try and focus on using audit machine learning to augment what testing is already available. So I try and use it mostly where we can target our testing more effectively. We can also use it to perform tests, but I don't think machine learning and AI is quite mature enough to perform those subjective tests that auditors do, where we can use machine learning to kind of help us identify potentially erroneous, you know, items in our audit testing more effectively. An example of this is where we're actually supporting an organization right now to look at their call data from contact centers and to then convert that into text to then identify whether if the appropriate policy requirements were met in that call by their staff. Now, if a person or an auditor was to sit down and go through each call, it would take a significant amount of time. Now, they could do sample testing, but using approaches where we can run through, you know, thousands of hours of call recording data quickly using, you know, cloud services as well as inbuilt house capability, we can, you know, take that effort down quite significantly and provide more of a population test over a sample test, which might help find more of those erroneous records. Furthermore, we can also do more advanced things around document text hunting, so using text analytics to help identify where some trends are in the documentation being filed for project management or, you know, other kind of minutes of meetings, etc. as well. Sentiment analysis over text and a few other use cases there as well in audit testing. But ultimately, like I said, the goal that I've seen quite commonly is to help audit find those erroneous records where their attention is most useful for a person to look at.
Thanks, Chipman. So, thinking back with my experience, helping organizations big and small. I think small organizations, in terms of using data analytics more generally in internal audit, are still struggling. But the big organizations appear to be running away with it. Is that your view of the industry as well?
Yeah, and I can see some of the people on the web on the conference today are from some of those organizations as well, interestingly. I definitely agree with some organizations that have a strong data analytics culture. They've taken it and ran away with it and done some amazing things. But that's not necessarily across the board. There's still a few who, in audit specifically, are still in a very early journey to move over to use of analytics across the board. You know, setting targets and driving the right behaviors can really help some organizations use their staff in audit more effectively to find, you know, and spend time on things that are most important, opposed to sifting through manual kind of testing itself. I've got a client right now I'm working with where they've just started on their journey for use of analytics, and they're partnering with us to help figure out where and what use cases it can be most effective, and kind of building up a framework. And they're a mid-tier insurance organization, right? So they have started using analytics across the board in their business, but audit just hasn't caught up. Where we've also got a MENA bank that we're working with who doesn't use analytics in the UK at all, but in their headquarters in the Middle East do use analytics in audit a bit more. So there's different ranges across the board.
Fantastic. Thanks, Chipman. Carolis, are you there? I've got a question for you if I can. So how is machine learning being used within during COVID-19 and this time of crisis?
So very similarly as you just showed with your let's say decision tree model, we see loads of medical institutions and scientists applying the same machine learning approaches of on gathered biometric environmental data of people who get infected to establish the features of the people that would be more impacted by it or more severely, you know, would get more severely ill, and what determines that. So in a very similar way as you showed, it can take in, you know, all these different genetic factors that they collect and environmental, their behavioral factors, and then say that if you're this particular type of person, you might be more at risk, and they can better focus their resources as like a country healthcare system or something by identifying those demographics and establishing, you know, who do we want to prioritize when we're taking care of people, because a different set of people might not have as severe symptoms from the virus as well. We also see scientists using the machine learning to even design the antibodies. So they will literally run through millions or billions of different shapes of the antibodies that would actually tie to the virus and neutralize it, as well as going through all the current medical components currently in trials to see if any of them could be combined in a way that would replicate the antibodies that they think would work. So therefore saving time going through trials again to release the cure or the vaccine quicker. I think an interesting point of how using the kind of same approaches have so many applications in so many different fields.
Thanks, Carolis. And of course, NIME as a tool being open source actually started in drug discovery and development. So if you download it and use it, yes, it's got banking modules and insurance modules and stuff you can use it in financial services, but there's still a whole load of legacy chemistry and biological stuff on there. And it's being used today to help the COVID crisis. Right. Thanks, Carolis. Thanks, Chipman. So moving on to something thankfully a little bit easier and simpler to follow, robotic process automation. And if you're like me, you'll get bored of those monthly jobs where you are just copying and pasting information between spreadsheets. And imagine if that was your job, doing a repetitive task day in, day out, copy, paste, sleep, repeat. And there's lots of clerical jobs out there, reading invoice details and entering data into your financial systems. People have good days and bad days. People have hangovers, no comments, noisy children during lockdown, for example. RPA doesn't have any of those things. But do remember the people risk that we mentioned earlier, because this applies just as much here. So I'm now going to show you a picture speaks a thousand words. So instead of rattling on about RPA, I'm going to show you a video of a bot which is operating a control, so you can see it in action. It's checking suppliers' VAT numbers against the EU master list held on the EUV's website. So this is a tool called Automation Anywhere that we have access to at Grant Thornton. And what the bot is doing is it's now taking example invoice details and sucking the information out and put it in a spreadsheet. So you can imagine somebody once upon a time having to take all that information and type it in, no more. And now what it's doing is obviously on that invoice, it will have the company's VAT registration number, and you are going to want to check that that number is correct. So there's a master repository of information held on an EC website, the V's website, and the bot can go out to that website just like a human could and scrape the information and check it. And you can probably just see where it's flashing green and red here. What it's doing is it's taken that information from the website and it's comparing it to the VAT number held within the invoice that it's sucked out and put it in the spreadsheet. And if it's wrong, it's red. And if it's right, it's green. So let's let it finish that job off. There we go. So now the bot is now creating separate reports, as it said. So it's taking the green stuff, the stuff that's right, and dumping it in one Excel spreadsheet. And it's taking the red stuff, the stuff that's wrong, and it's dumping it in another Excel spreadsheet. Fast, isn't it? A lot faster than a human. So now Bertie's deciding to send some emails. Now that he or she, of course, has finished its job, it's going to send that information to who needs to know it in the firm. And off it goes. And I like the way we've given it a job title and a signature. So you can see that appears really easy. And really, it is as simple as that. And this isn't really new technology. I mean, people say to me, isn't this just a macro? And if I'm honest, it is. It's a clever macro that can do, RPA is a clever macro that can do anything that a user could do in a computer. And just like a macro, you can let it run without intervention, or you can intervene at times. The RPA equivalent is what we call attended or unattended bots. Unattended bots run in the background, usually scheduled by IT day after day. They're useful in solving lots of complicated problems that creating a program to do is just too difficult, too expensive, or would just take too long. For example, imagine an interface between complex systems. Say all the completions on a mortgage sales system need moving over to the core mortgage system and all the dead applications are archived. A bot can do that. An attended system is one in which RPA can help semi-automate processes. For example, I've done a lot of work in the sanction space, and working those alerts can be soul-destroying for the team members who have to do it. And you get a member of staff who isn't interested and you've got a problem with somebody who just keeps pressing the button. And they may cut corners in the investigation. But a bot can help. A bot can go out to Google, search for your customer, retrieve the information on the accounts from across your bank on different systems, and pull it all into one place for the team member to review. And with RPA that has machine learning built into it, you can quickly help it learn. Remember, we talked about supervised learning earlier. What is a true hit and what is a false positive? So it can even give you an early view on whether an alert is likely to be a false positive or a true positive. So as you can see, RPAs and cyborgs come to kill you. It's just a fancy macro. Finally here, what are the risks? Well, when you build a macro, as we all know, it can go wrong, particularly if it finds something that it hasn't seen before. And if you don't write the code properly, you can't reverse it. And whilst that's probably okay for a macro that you trigger and review the output set at your desktop, that's not okay for RPA that may run well indefinitely. You need to build bots with good software development processes in mind. Error handling, for example, makes sure that it knows how to deal with something it hasn't seen before. That could be as simple as splitting the case out into an exceptions queue for manual intervention. And that's not a problem if you end up with a queue that has 10 exceptions from a process population of, say, 1 million records. Nobody would argue that that isn't a good result. But it doesn't appear so much of a good result if you have a queue of 100,000 exceptions. But think outside the box. That's a 90% reduction. And just like any piece of software, you can refine and re-release with improvements to get that number down. So finally, and quite quickly, because we're running out of time and I'd like to take some questions, I'm just going to cover this very quickly. Blockchain. Everyone in the call has probably heard of Bitcoin, and you likely know that it's powered by blockchain. But what on earth is blockchain? And for once, for those of you that know it, Wikipedia probably has the most simple definition I've come across. So I'm going to just simply read it to you. A blockchain is a growing list of records called blocks that are linked using cryptography. Each block contains a cryptographic hash of the previous block, a timestamp, and transaction data. By design, a blockchain is resistant to modification of the data. It is an open, distributed ledger that can record transactions between two parties efficiently and in a verifiable and permanent way. For use as a distributed ledger, a blockchain is typically managed by a peer-to-peer network collectively adhering to a protocol for communication and validating new blocks. So, if you think of Bitcoin, and if you put that really simply, each Bitcoin transaction gets added to a block to the list of previous transactions, which are also held as blocks. It is secure because the new transaction block contains a cryptographic hash. That is an encrypted summary of the previous block, which of course contained an encrypted summary of the previous block before it. And it is unique because each block has a timestamp, the transaction detail, and the cryptographic hash that we've just mentioned. This means that all transactions are, of course, traceable, and data quality is enforced because to some degree, the blockchain is copied or available to the whole network through that hashing process. So if you could fudge your block, so to speak, you'd have to break the encryption, and then every other relevant summation of the information of that block would need to be updated, which is virtually, if not totally, impossible. However, blockchain is not without criticism. Think about it. You may have saved yourself some storage space as this is a distributed ledger, but across the world, there will be lots of redundant copies of data, leading to storage issues globally. That means lots of devices being powered, i.e. this makes this not very green as that uses a lot of energy. And because it's decentralized and encrypted, there is no central point that can be regulated, controlled, or inspected. Some people may say that's good. I know regulators are gonna, and governments are going to say that's bad. Banks are looking at this technology for their own payment messaging systems. In trade finance, the automation of transactions essential to trade finance will help the financial services industry make huge savings after blockchain solutions are introduced. The use of smart contracts to automate approval workflows and clearing calculations will help reduce processing times and enable banks to massively reduce the number of employees needed for this task too. And going back to our old favorite KYC, since blockchains cannot be altered, you can ID and be your customer, know your customer. And then since that person written into blockchain, every subsequent transaction can be traced to that verified individual. So whilst as any new technology has hype associated with it, blockchain does have a very promising future, although it might not be quite as visible to the future as a bot or machine learner. Thank you for listening. So let's take some questions. I don't know whether we've got any coming through on the chat. Let me have a look. So we've got one here from Mohammed Mullet. I do apologize. Can we please summarize RPA? I think that's a very good question. So if nobody could come at it from before, let's talk about RPA again. Robotic process automation, RPA, is a way of basically automating what anybody does on a desktop. So whereas an individual previously would have taken invoices, for example, and would have manually read that invoice and typed it into, say, a database, RPA can do that for you. It can do anything that's on a desktop that is a manual repetitive task, as long as the data is in a regular format. And it doesn't have to be perfect because you can build AI into the solution. It doesn't have to be perfect. But as long as the bot can figure out where that information is, it can do something with it. And then RPA is very good at making logic type decisions. So do I add that invoice to a database or do I stick it in an exceptions queue because there's something wrong with it? Does that answer your question, Mohammed? Ah, so another question from Mohammed. Does this mean it still requires human oversight? There we go. Or will this mean that it doesn't take human oversight? Well, the best way to build an RPA solution is, Mohammed, is to probably think of it like a piece of software. So in a piece of software, you would create something, you would build it, and you would test it. And that is the right thing to do with RPA. Create it, build it, test it. If you have examples of RPA in live, you may wish to see that they have got controls built into them, for example. So say I'm copying across those invoices previously into a database. I might want the RPA to keep a running total of all the invoices that it's found, and then the invoices that have been loaded, I'll take an independent check of the total of the invoices loaded, and I'll check off the two, and that checks it, it's correct. But remember, probably one of the biggest problems with RPA is making sure that you don't overestimate what it can do. Can I just check that everybody goes on to mute? Is that you, Chipman?
Yes, that's me, Jamie. I was just going to add on to your answer there as well after.
Okay. So making sure that anything that it can't deal with, it goes into exception queue for manual oversight. And of course, in an attended bot, you're not always automating the full process. You're automating parts of processes. And those parts of processes may not sound very exciting, but if they're chunky and they take a lot of time, you're saving your business quite a lot of time. Chipman.
I was just going to add that RPA has kind of two really key components to it. There's activities that are objective and there's activities that are subjective, right? So objective ones being that they've got a very clear, well-defined rule set that the activity can follow, in which case I would say it's like code. It will always do the same thing you tell it to because you've given it a rule set and will require less human oversight, where you could also put it over subjective processes where it's making more of a machine learning type decision, you know, based on some train data that you've given it, and then now it's actually implementing it. So that's where I would say human oversight is required, as with any other machine learning or AI implementation, is you don't want to let it run on its own without any kind of, monitoring to make sure it doesn't go rogue or it doesn't start following a pattern and causing a market crash like the example Jamie gave earlier. So depending on what the use case is, I think it could require oversight or it couldn't. So it depends exactly how you've implemented and over what process.
Thanks, Chipman. So you have a couple of questions here from Phil Reed. Have you seen any examples of internal audit teams using these tools as part of continuous monitoring solutions? And has data in these tools got a role to play in the annual planning cycle for assurance functions? So I'll start with the latter because that's certainly easier. Yes, data should have a role in the planning cycle for assurance functions. So think back to that paper for from the Institute of Internal Auditors that the internal audit should have an independent view of risk. That was a big moment to turn the tables in internal audit. And one of the ways some of the bigger institutions have reacted to that is by having their own continuous risk monitoring interfaces. So having an internal audit database that takes transactions or is plugged into your group data warehouse, for example, and then can pull out key risk monitoring indicators. So your audit planning cycle stays away from once upon a time, oh, I think we've got an added, you know, we've got a risk here in, I don't know, debtors or creditors or mortgages, and I'm going to go and do an audit. Actually, you know what? It becomes a bit more intelligent. I've got some KRIs that are sitting there running in the background, and those KRIs can actually be more like controls in a way. And all of a sudden something goes outside of tolerance or banned or it's not reporting properly. Actually, you know what? It's time for an audit. So having those KRIs through data analytics is key to making sure that you've got a more clever and intelligent way of targeting your audits at the area of greatest risk. So in terms of have we seen RPA take a role in third line audit testing, I certainly haven't yet. I've seen it happen in first line. as a control, I've not seen it happen in third line. And that's because probably in financial services, third line and continuous monitoring is something that we would expect the first line to do. I can certainly see, though, that the third line should be expecting the first line to be able to do this. And, you know, we're all in it together, generally, is my view in audit. And some auditors may have an allergic reaction to that, but I don't see there anything wrong with, you know, the third line opening the eyes to the first line and saying, this is how you do it. This is your prototype. There you go. I hope that answers your questions. So we've got two more minutes. I'll take some more. I'll have a look through the questions and see what we can see here. Right, one from Mark. And if there's any questions I can't, we don't answer today, I'll get back to you after this. Mark, as firms adopt AI and RPA, how are they developing governance models to address issues such as SMCR, i.e. if the machine is learning, who has the accountability if it goes wrong? Really good question. As we said before, who does have the accountability that goes wrong? And there are people saying, is it a persona at law? And those models, those questions are being worked through by the lawyers as we speak. The answer is there is no easy answer to this right now, and everybody is still in the same boat. In terms of senior management regime under systems and controls, I'm sure the FCA would expect you to understand what is being used in your organization, what the impact could be. And even if it is a black box, because these things are so complicated, we don't understand, we need to be very clear on the parameters in which they work. If we're not clear on the parameters in which they work, we need to be putting our hands up as senior managers and saying, I'm not comfortable with the risk profile this leads to our firm. Chipman, you come on.
Yeah, I was just going to add on to that as well. So with AI and RPA, there's also an element of explainability. So a new topic that's being kind of investigated right now is explainable AI, which, you know, typically if you've built a model, it's quite hard to look at the underlying workings of that model. And that's where, you know, there's actual activity going on where they're overlaying an additional AI on top of a model to explain how it works and what it's doing internally. And that's becoming quite an interesting field of study. So that's limiting to an extent how AI can be used in different use cases in a good way, because we're actually going to be able to, you know, say that if a person has had a decision made over, say, a lending application, what have been the attributes that led to it, which in typical AI implementations, you wouldn't be able to actually trace back. So those definitely have quite a big impact on how accountability works there as well.
Thanks, Chipman. And I think it's important to say that in any tech development, that if you start adding more things into the mix, like explainability, the greater the chance of you slowing down the machine learning algorithm and making it harder for it to work in real time is a real risk. So there is a balance there. But going back to the question, making sure that you can encapsulate that machine learning and you know in which frame of reference that it's going to work is absolutely critical under the senior manager's regime, I would have said. Right, thank you everybody for joining. We've gone a 1 minute over. Sorry about that. Thanks for all the great questions that are appearing in the chat. What we'll do is we'll try and get back to you afterwards if we haven't managed to answer your question. And of course, if you've got any feedback or you just want to talk this through with us and understand a little bit more about how we are using machine learning and internal audit right now and how we can possibly help you, do let us know. Thank you very much for attending. Goodbye.